tonight's the yahrzeit of the Rebbe Reb Zusha, so we have to sing Anapoli. Reb Zusha of Anapoli, tonight's his yahrzeit, so we gotta sing the niggun, Bet Shvat, we gotta sing the niggun of the Rebbe that came down in Anapoli by the kever of the Rebbe Reb Zusha.
Reb Zusha is so cold.
Huh?
That one's
so cold. He's so hungry, he's everything. Zusha. Okay, so this is the niggun. We continue to learn this whole week. Lilui Nishmas, Miriam's Abba. When is the actual Yahrzeit, by the way?
Tonight.
Oh, it's tonight, really? Oh, that's special to be together, Dafka, in the night. Even though we're learning all week, but Dafka in the Yahrzeit, Bet Shvat, that's beautiful to be together. 5 years, you said, nechon? Lilui Nishmas Menachem ben Shmuel Eliezer Veliba Feldman. Right? Tehen Nishmas Otsura B'tzura Chaim Be'ezrat Hashem. Okay, but was Bob Dylan was a good singer or like a gewalt storyteller? Storyteller, right? Does anyone want to have another opinion? Huh? Oh, are poets storytellers?
Mm-hmm.
Sure, poetry is storytelling. It's a different type of storytelling, but it's storytelling. If you think about the moments that were the greatest transformations in your life, was it a piece of Torah you learned or was it a story that you heard? And yet, we still have a problem with putting the value of a story where it needs to be. And the whole Torah is one big story, and our lives are a story. I heard Rabbi Tarragon once say, Rabbi Moshe Tarragon once said that that the saddest thing about humanity is that we forget that we're in the middle of our own story. We don't treat our lives like stories. We treat our lives like books of principles, or you know, it's just whatever. He didn't say that, I'm just adding on to me. He said books of statements, but that it's ke'ilu, a story. Perek Aleph, Perek Bet, Perek Gimel, Perek Dalet. Our lives are a sipur. They really are. They're one long, beautiful story. And I think the avoda that we need to do, and the era that we need to enter into in terms of our Yiddishkeit, is remembering what the whole Chiddush of the Baal Shem Tov was, that we always say. And one of the key elements of what the Baal Shem Tov brought down was that a sipur, the story is not like a nice, cute way to get someone interested. It's a key element of our approach to practicing our Yiddishkeit. Storytelling, what a story is all about. Now you all know that in the Parshiot, Va'era, Bo, by the Rebbes, these Parshiot were like the Kedusha of Pesach. Because it's the story of Pesach, these Parshiot. And by some of the tzaddikim, they would actually read the Haggadah I forget which one, the vision it's there. He would read the Haggadah on Parshas Bo, Va'ira, Bo, these Parshias. Because this inyan of Higata Lebincha, of telling your children the story and everything that entails, it's already now, it's in these Parshiot. But you know what a beautiful world is, a beautiful life is? A beautiful day is if you look back today at your life and forget about what you felt or how good or how bad it was. Can you look back, it's now 8 p.m., can you look back the last 11 hours, in our case 12, 13 hours for some parents who have been awake for 12, 13 hours, right? 14 hours? 15 hours? Yeah. we can keep on going back, right? And even if you just, even if you passed out cold, whatever, and you woke up at 11:30 somehow this morning, right? And you made it to the last challah, the last minyan of the shtiblach. Do you look at today as a story? And if you don't, then why is it so hard? Why is it so difficult to look at your life like a story, like a sipu? What makes it so difficult? And that's a very important thing. Because if you're able to look at your life as a sipur, your life is beautiful. And you also know that even if today was Perek Gimel or Dalid, like in Megillas Esther, you also believe there's going to be Perek Zayin and Chet, Perek Tet. But if today wasn't a story, if your life wasn't a story today, and your life was just another day of being sentenced, or whatever, fill in the blank, but not a story, then what was the point of Hashem giving you today? What was the point of it? So it's a big inyan, it's a big limud, it's not a simple thing what we're talking about. And tonight what we're going to be discussing is that this way of looking at life is a key role in the Geula. It was a key role in the Geula, that's what it was, the Geula that was, and it's going to be a key role in how the Geula is taking place and manifesting today as well. So we're going to see a few very, very special things over here. Obviously it's all based on the second pasuk in the Parsha, if you can pass these out. So I want to learn a little bit from a bunch of different places tonight to try to understand this inyan of the power of the story and what it really is all about. Okay. Oh, I feel that section over there is so far. Can you guys come closer? Do you mind? No. It's so far. I can't even make eye contact with anybody. All right. Did everyone get? Joni, I don't want to burn. I don't want you to burn over there. Okay. You're always next to the fire, Batsheva. Joni's not, but Batsheva is. Okay. So you all know that this parsha begins. I don't have the first pasuk here, but you know the first part. The pasuk is Bo el Paro. Hashem tells Moshe Rabbeinu, Bo, come with me to Paro. For many years when we were learning, we were just learning that first word. Why doesn't the Torah say Lech el Paro? Why doesn't Hashem say go to Paro? And Hashem says to Moshe Rabbeinu, come to Paro. So tonight I want to learn why it says come to Paro, but not focusing at all on that pasuk, focusing on the next pasuk. So the pasuk, the parsha begins, Emam Hashem Moshe bo el Paro ki ani hichbadeti yislibo v'yisliv avadav leman shisi asosai ele bekirbo. Come to Paro. I've done a number on him, right? Come to Paro. I've really, really given it to him, and a lot of things are happening there. Now look at the pasuk is the first one that you have on top, which is the topic of tonight's shir. Uleman, the reason why I want you to come to Paro, the reason why I want the story to continue to envelop and pan out in the most miraculous way, uleman tesaper beozne bincha uven bincha et asher hitalalti v'mitzrayim v'et ototai asher samti bam V'idatem ken Hashem. The reason I want you to come close is because I'm going to give you front row to a story. You're going to, Moshe Rabbeinu, you're going to see a story up front, and later you're going to tell Am Yisrael, you need to share into the ears of your children and your grandchildren what you saw. What came of this? The night that's most central in our calendar, which is Leil Seder. It's the night that, you know, we usually, no matter what's happening in our lives, we don't miss. I was in the studio this week, and the studio manager was so excited to tell me about a festival that he's going to in Los Angeles called Coachella. I don't know if you've heard of it. And I was like, wow, interesting. What are the dates? So he tells me, I'm like, wow, that's so interesting. I'm going to be there also around then with me. But I'm gonna be there around Pesach time. So he's like, check the dates. Leil Seder, Mamish Kocha is like,
huh?
Not only did it mean something to him, Gamarnu, meaning it's done. It's not like, oh, let me see how I could work. Maybe this year I'll miss it, right? Ah, Sukkot, maybe he'll miss. Even Rosh Hashanah, right? Leil Seder, how did this happen? Because once upon a time, Moshe Rabbeinu was invited to the front row of a story. Mm. And Hashem says to him, you have to look at this, and you have to teach Yidden that whatever they're going to see from now on, and really what they've been seeing for a while already, you have to give it over. You have to tell the story. And the question is, why? Why is that the whole Inyan? What is so important about that? Is the commandment on the person telling the story? I could sound yeshivish right now. Is the commandment on the person telling the story? Or is the chalois of the mitzvah? Or is the commandment on the person that needs to hear it? And the nafka mina, meaning, and what's the difference, what's derived differently between the two? And that's really what we're doing tonight. Who is this mitzvah on? The person telling or the person hearing? And what's the difference? What are the ramifications? What's different between the two? And you'll see there'll be a lot of things that we're going to learn about ourselves right now. Because I know that anyone in here that remembers being a child or that has children knows that you want to get close to your child, don't start giving over to them encyclopedias of information. All they want and all that establishes closeness is a sipul, is a story. So the first makor we have tonight, we do a little bit of Hebrew, a little bit of English, even though it seems like we're not going to do everything in here tonight. Don't get startled. It's already late and everyone's really thinking about Bibi, so we're just going to do as much as we can in here tonight. The Belzer Rebbe says like this. This is a Torah from the Belzer Rebbe, a beautiful teaching from the Belzer. We don't normally learn Torahs from the Belzer Rebbe, but I saw this teaching. I said, this is exactly it. And he's going to go into the diuk of the Pasuk. In order for us to learn what the Torah is telling us, each word in the Parsha is very, very important. V'yesh ledakdek, the Belzer Rebbe says, look at the end of the pasuk on top. What does it say? V'idatem k'ani Hashem. Meaning Hashem tells Moshe Rabbeinu, you and Am Yisrael have to tell over the story of what your eyes saw. And then the pasuk ends off by saying, V'idatem, and you will know that I am Hashem. The Belzer Rebbe says, what should have been written? V'yid'u. And the people that you're telling the story to, they will know, because you told them a story, they will know, meaning the information, the story will be given over, and they will know, the people you're telling the story to. But the pasuk says, no. V'idatem means they and you. It actually means more you than them, if you think about it. If Hashem's talking to someone, he says V'idatem, he's talking to you. So the Belzer Rebbe is saying, why does it say they will know? Why doesn't it say they will know that the Bar Hashem? And Hashem is saying, you're going to tell over a story, and you're going to know that I'm God. That's the lashon of the pasuk. You could already see where he's going with this. Ki medabrim kan al banim sheyedu et Hashem al yedei shenesaper lehem. Sorry, al yedei shenesaper lehem nisei yitziat Mitzrayim. Amai katuv v'yedatem. Again, why does it say, you will know? You're talking about those that are going to be receiving a story. They should know. Is the question clear? It's pretty much, if it's not clear, I don't want to continue. Is it clear to everybody, the question? Okay. V'yesh lomar, d'kasher adam rotze l'hashrish b'lev chavero dvar emunah. Interesting. We keep on seeing this word in different svarim. L'hashrish. What sefer have we been seeing it in? The Vavi. Yeah, it's coming up a lot over there. L'hashrish means to make something into the root, to root something. L'hashrish. So he says, when a person wants to make, to root something in the heart of his friend, dvar emunah, like you want to give emunah over to your friend, but want it to go inside chazak, or you want to rebuke them. Tzarich mikodem hu leha'amin be'oto hadavar be'emunah shlema. That person first has to believe be'emunah shlema in what they're about to give over. Has to. If not, the person hearing what you're saying can tell where it's coming from. We've had this quite often with different teachers and rabbis and mashpiim over the years, that they were saying the stuff they knew they were supposed to say. But you want to always take them to a side room after they gave over a whole spiel and emuna and say, tell me something. You really buy what you said? Be'emet? Come on. For real? Like, you mamish believe in what you said? Because the way you gave it over, it felt like you were saying the right things. But it almost felt like you were on just like this. You put in your mind what you're supposed to say and how you're supposed to say it, and then you pressed play when you started talking. There are people like that. So he says over here, first, when you give over something, you have to ma'amin, you have to believe with full emuna, uli kshot et atzmo. You know what kshot means?
Decorate.
Right, but when we say it in Aramaic, likshot et atzmo, it's like emet. It's like truth and beauty. And meaning you have to make sure that all of you is fully one with what you're about to say. Ve'az, and then when you're in that state of mind and you're about to give over to somebody some words of emunah, ve'az yu dvarim yotzi min alev, v'ikansu el alev. Then, the words are going to be coming out of your heart. They're going to go into someone else's heart. Aval im lo yachzik betoch atzmo et ha'emunah, lo yuchal le'oshpia ota al achirim. But if it's not what you're holding, you won't be able to give it over to other people. Now, everyone should be nervously grinning and smiling and laughing right now. Why? Why? Because those of us that are blessed with children are faced with this all the time. A child cannot tolerate an ounce of non-authentic divrei emunah and divrei Torah. They could tell. They could tell at a young age. They could always tell. We always speak about this. They don't. The filter, it doesn't work by children. By adults, sometimes it works. You can still get by showing that you know enough information. So the receiver sees, oh, they know their stuff. A child doesn't care if you know your stuff. A child cares about, do you feel your stuff? Do you feel what you're saying? Where is it coming from? This is what the bells are saying over here. Bezeh perusha pasuk. Look at the bottom paragraph over here. And this is what the pasuk means: Uleman tesaper beoznei bincha uven bincha. So you should have the privilege of giving this over into the ears of your children and the children's children. Shekedei likboa haemuna belev bneichem. You want to mamash establish the emuna in your children, like all of us in this room. We want our children to be bale emuna. Nachon. What wouldn't we do for our children to grow up? And I'm not talking about how frum they are. I'm talking about how much emuna they have. That's what we want. Our children to walk around with emuna in their hearts. Aye, so what's the problem, though? Not a problem, but what's the prerequisite for it? Shekedei likvoa emuna belev bnechem, tzrichim atem bitchila ladat batzmechem, ki ani Hashem. You need to know, first of all, that I am Hashem. ולהאמין באמונה שלמה, and to fully believe. ואז תוכלו לקבוע אמונה בלב בניכם. And only then, the Bells of Heaven says, can you establish this concept called emunah in the hearts of your children. So what question did he answer? Very clearly. Hashem says, you're going to go and tell the story to your children? וידעתם. And you will all then know that I am Hashem. Why? Because when you really work on yourself and then you give it over, I've seen this so many times. I could prepare a shir, but really, it only really goes inside, and I feel much more connected to it when I'm giving it over. It's true, like it's mamish like this in almost every area of meaning. As much as you prepare yourself, there's something about this aspect of giving it over that makes it more established and permanent into you. Now, what do you have to do? What do you have to be in order to have it really permeated within you? You have to be close to what you're saying. If not, it's just like every other shir you've gone to, that you walk out with a lot more of information and you wonder, how come my life isn't changed? You wonder, how come my life hasn't been transformed? But I'll go to another information setting. That's what they are. It's holy information. I'm not saying it's not holy information. It's holy information, but you sit there, you're wondering, how come I'm not really changed? Why? How close are you to what you're hearing, to what you're saying? So what the Belzer Rebbe said over here, again, parents to give over Hashem to their children need to be close to the concept of Hashem that they're talking about. Now that's a very, very big thing for us because it really makes us be on top of our game. Because like we always said, the child can tell. I'm going to go back in a few minutes to the piece beneath, but go down to the last page. The third page. And the third page, this is words from Rabbi Shlomo. His name's on the bottom of the page before. And Rabbi Shlomo is going to speak about storytelling. It's interesting. Hashem didn't say to Moshe Rabbeinu, tell them over laws, and then they'll know that I'm Hashem. Right? He didn't say to them, go and give them a shir on Hilchos Melicha, or even Hilchos Emuna. He said, the way that it's going to become clear to you that I'm Hashem is by you mastering the art of storytelling. That's what he said to them. You ever think that? Hashem could have told him, listen, he could have said, we get the first three mitzvahs this Shabbos, right? We get the mitzvah of Kiddush HaChodesh, right? We have it this Shabbos, the first mitzvah. So Hashem could have told Moshe, like, listen, the way you could really make it in them, carve them into being Yidden, take the first commandment, mitzvahs. Take the mitzvah and give it over, and by giving over the first mitzvah, you're going to know that I'm Hashem. It's not what Hashem tells Moshe Rabbeinu. He says, Leman tesaper, go and tell them a story, and then you'll know that I'm Hashem. But why was Hashem doing this? Why did Hashem Dafka choose that hashrashat ha'emuna, that rooting emuna into our beings would be through storytelling and not through delivering information, even if it's the holiest information in the world? You hear the shayla, right? So this piece from Reb Shlomo, we once learned a few paragraphs of it in one of the Shabbos afternoon shiurim a long time ago. It's okay to repeat these things. Okay to repeat stories as well, right? Okay. Reb Shlomo says you don't have to be close to somebody to tell them facts. But you have to be very close to tell somebody a story. It's a very interesting line. Until the holy Baal Shem Tov came about to the world, even among the Yidden, the most important thing is telling each other good words, holy words, teachings. You gave over a vort. The holy Baal Shem brought down the light of Mashiach. And the first sign of the light of Mashiach is that people tell each other stories again. Children who are so pure and so holy, they're not interested in teachings. They want to hear a good story. When you tell children a good story, you just barely finish the story and they want to hear it again. Us adults, when we hear a story once, we think we know it. Who talks about knowing? When it comes to a story, it's not a question of if you know it or not. It's a story. It's so holy. And this is what I wanted to really point out over here. This is very important. And I think I know I shared with you a number of times my first real encounter with a master storyteller. You know, a lot of my friends are master storytellers, but the first one that I really heard it, I felt like they were giving me over the Torah of storytelling, was Rav Natan Siegel, Alav Hashalom. How many of you knew Rav Natan, besides this wing of the room? Did anyone? Yeah, Zelda, you know, of course. You didn't know Rav Natan?
I did.
Oh, you raised your hand. Yeah, yeah, of course. So Rav Natan Siegel, many of the women here know Rav Natan's almana, his widow, Leah, who comes and learns with us sometimes. Rav Natan was one of my rabbeim in Hamiftar when I first came to the yeshiva. He was the first rabbi that I met in the yeshiva as the rabbi of the yeshiva. And I thought after meeting him that the whole yeshiva was like him. I was like, wow, oh my God. I can't believe, like, this is what the whole yeshiva is like. I wasn't, but it's okay, it's fine. Everyone played its role. Anyway, he comes to shir. He came with us to daven with us on Shacharis. And then he came in that same day daven with us Mariv. So when a Rav would come for a davening, he'd also give over a Dvar Torah, a Dvar Halacha, after davening, whatever the tefillah was, I think it was that. And he comes and he says over a Gevald story, I actually think for some reason it was a Reb Zusha story, but I don't remember exactly. I probably have it written down somewhere. And he said an amazing story, and we were mamish like this, we couldn't believe, like, wow, mamish Gevald story. So that was 7:15, 8 a.m., let's say we finished, 8 a.m. Mayrev's 8:30, I think. He was there for Mayrev too, 8:45. He gets up for Mayrev. After Mayrev, he goes up to the Bima, and he says an amazing, amazing, amazing story. The only thing is, it was the same exact story he said in Shabbos. You know when you're really embarrassed, you don't want to make eye contact with anybody because you'll start laughing? Right? If like a bunch of people feel very embarrassed and awkward, you don't look at somebody because then you start, you know, whatever. So the whole base midrash, like what we just go like this, you know, you just look at a page, even if you're looking at a sitter that you just finished davening Mariv, suddenly the sitter becomes so interesting because we couldn't make eye contact with Rav Siegel. The same exact story. And I'll never, ever forget the line he said because it's this Torah. He said, I know what you're all thinking right now. Siegel definitely lost all his marbles this time. That's what he said. Those are his words. Siegel definitely lost his marbles this time. He says, you don't think I know what I said this morning? So first of all of us were like, oh, phew. So he's not, you know, at least we're not dealing with that, you know, that problem, right? He says, do you think a Hasidish story is about knowing it and hearing it once and say you knew it? And he didn't say anything else afterwards. So this is the same thing that is addressed in this last few lines over here. Is that most of us, when we hear a story, for instance, in Shul, last Shabbos, the Freundlich, the Wiesen Bar Mitzvah, so the brother of the mother Bar Mitzvah, said over a story. And he said over a story of the Baal Shem Tov that I've given over, Shoshana's given over, and probably two others have given over in the last year. Because it's an amazing story. But everyone gives over something through the story, through the way that they say the story. And I was mamish listening, I could see the mamish, the first line he said, I'm like, yeah, okay. Let's see what you're gonna give over with the same exact story that everyone knows. But what happens to the Eitz HaDa'at ear? The Eitz HaDa'at ear hears a story that they know, and they say, I know this one already. And what do they prevent them? What do they basically prevent themselves from receiving? More Chaim, because that's what we get through Sipurim. So we're not asking you, did you know a story? A story is not a shayla of, you know, honestly, how many times can we hear Seder Pesach? The story of the Haggadah, Yetzias Mitzrayim. And yet we show up every single year because we know that it's not about how well we know the story. It's about where is the story, how is the story being given over this year, and how is it touching me this year? Okay, let's go back inside. You know what I call an assimilated Jew and what I call a non-assimilated Jew? An assimilated Jew is the one who the only story he tells his children is Sesame Street. You have nothing Jewish to tell your children? Children soak up stories. They mamish, they're inhaling the stories they're told. How do you expect children to be yidden if there's not one Jewish story in their head, in their heart? I see it with my children. I'll tell them a story about Reb Nachman, about... I try to tell them stories about tzaddikim also that we have pictures of, so it's maybe a bit easier for them to relate. My children's relationship to the Eish Kodesh is something that if I came back 30 Gilgulim, I wouldn't reach. Only because what? Because Bina and I tell them stories about the Eish, we talk about the Eish Kodesh. And his face is on the wall in our living room. So their relationship to the Eish Kodesh is something that's so, Baruch Hashem, ingrained in them, because they could hear the same thing over and over again. Tiferet got a book recently of, remember the I have to get the third volume actually, about the, when we went to the Sfarim sale, about the,
With the Baal Shem Tov, or not the Baal Shem Tov.
The Baal Tanya, Rabbi Levi Yitzchak Berditchim.
And Zusha and Eli Melech.
Right. They can read the same story over and over again because they know it's not about Da'at, it's about Chaim. If it's about Da'at, knowledge, I have that one covered. I don't need to hear that. I already went through Hilchos Nida. I don't have to learn it again. I already went through Hilchos Shmir Shabbos for Smich. I went through it. I'm fine. It's not how we live. Because really, essentially, the highest level is to be able to hear a story while you're learning also halacha. That's the highest level. To make halacha into a story as well. Because then you don't treat it as something that, I got that covered. I did that already. You're inviting more chias into your life, more livelihood into your life. Someone came to visit one of the Yidda Kodesh's Einik Lach, who was a big Rebbe. The Yidda Kodesh, Rabbi Yaakov Yitzchak from Pshischa, right? He called in a little boy of 5, and he says to the chassid who came to visit, do you see this chassidish boy of 5? He knows 800 chassidish stories by heart. You can imagine what kind of a Rebbe this boy will be. Now, what's the point of him saying this story? That by the Yidda Kodesh, you know, it was considered greatness? Not necessarily how many Shas Mishnayas is the kid finished when they were 7, but rather what? How many stories they know. That language is very uncommon, unfortunately, in the world. Like, you don't look at a kid and say, wow, this kid's a prodigy. Why? He knows 500, he knows 20 stories of the Vilna Gaon. It doesn't matter who it is. It's irrelevant. But you don't look at a kid and say, you know, he knows a story about the Nitziv, about Reb Chaim Eiser, about Reb Chaim Shmulev. Like, we don't look at that like that. We say, how much has he already filled his stomach with poskim? Now, God forbid, I hope by now you realize that we never belittle any level of Talmud Torah. But what we do belittle is those who belittle the value of Amkus, of Chassidish's story. That's where it's problematic. People always talk about better education. Get more stories. Get more good stories. That's all there is to it. People are only friends when they tell each other stories. People have been conventions and they tell each other theories. But they're not becoming friends by it. But when people sit and tell each other stories, they really become friends. Praying is very deep. But Reb Nachman says, this is not the deepest closeness to Hashem. The deepest depths of closeness to Hashem is when you're able to tell Hashem a story. Okay, so I'm just going to ask something. Again, no hand raising. When was the last time you told HaKadosh Baruch Hu a story? Not. Did what you're supposed to do with tefillah. Learned as much as you're supposed to. When was the last time you told the Ribbono Shelanim a story?
Like it bothered you?
Ah, very good. Yes. As simple as it is. That's the point of his bothered. But what he said before is the point. He said, you don't tell someone a story unless you're close to them. Do you know how many people practice Yiddishkeit and never ever understood or thought that closeness is a goal? They viewed it as, maybe it's a privilege of Schut Avod if that happens to me. When Reb Nachman comes and twists the whole thing over, he says, wait a second. You really think you were meant to come into this world, do everything right, but never have this concept of the option of feeling close to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? So how, okay, so since we know that that must be, how do you do that? Can you tell Hashem a story? Can you tell Hashem a story? So it's very good, Mata Esther, what you're saying. So here he continues, he says, Reb Nachman would tell God stories all the time. He would tell him, listen, God, this morning I woke up at 5 o'clock. And he would tell everything he did, a story. Like his Bodhidus, we also think like his Bodhidus has become like non-story sessions already. It's become like, okay, filling in the obligation of what I have to do in his Bodhidus when there isn't any. Ah, so what are you left with? You got to tell a story. But that's like very vulnerable. Yeah, it is. It is. Yeah, it's very vulnerable. It's very, very, it's very different. You know what it's called? It means being close to your words. You could say, you could be Yotzei Yedei Chova every word of davening and finish learning every word in the Torah, and you're Yotzei all of it without being close to it. But to tell a story, you can't do it unless you're close to what you're saying. So now let's go back. What did the Ribbono Shel tell Moshe Rabbeinu to do in order for them to really be ready for redemption, essentially? What was he telling them to do? That they had to be? They had to be close to each other. That's really what Hashem was telling Moshe Rabbeinu. He wasn't telling them, listen, tell them the story so they remember I'm God. He was saying, I am God, and you'll feel me being God, and you'll know that I'm God. You'll feel it when you establish closeness between parents and children. That is the Ani Hashem. V'yidatem ki Ani Hashem. That's how we're learning this out. Now, who needed to know this first, more than anybody? Who? Moshe. Why?
Because he couldn't be authentic until he knew that he was going to share it.
But why don't we assume that his that it was happening anyway? That they were all experiencing it. He didn't have to work too hard to explain to them something that they were seeing. Well, Nachum, but by now he's not in the castle. It's true if, like, the first 80 years, but by here, he's 80 years, now he's already maybe 81 by now.
Because for him to give it over, he has to believe it.
Ah, so first of all, it starts with that. But there's another factual problem here as well that I saw that mamish blew my mind. And I called Avi Miller before Shir because he learns with Rav Neria's grandson, the former chief rabbi of Yeshiva Bnei Akiva, Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria. And his grandson, Rav Yitzchak Neria, is the Rav here of the Hasdi Yeshiva, who we have a beautiful relationship with. And I saw a Torah from Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria about this topic that blew my mind, so I wanted to show it to you. It's in a Sefer by Rav Nevinson. It's on the first page. How are we doing with time? We're okay? A few more minutes? We're good. Okay. So Rav Neria says like this. Now we're trying to establish that. I just want to repeat what we just said until now. Hashem told Moshe Rabbeinu to be really ready for Geula. You could call it telling a story to your children, but what it really is, you have to feel close to your children. And only them you'll know. V'idatem keni Hashem. You and your child will know that I am Hashem because you'll feel it. That's what a story establishes. Okay?
It's also very intimate.
Oh, yeah. Into the ear. Yeah. Yeah. Very good.
And from the last parashah, when he doubted Hashem, like, what are you doing to the people? Hashem started dealing with him in the name Elohim, which automatically created a space of distance. There wasn't closeness there. And so he's reestablishing the closeness through the process.
Very nice.
That's how Yehuda got close into Yosef and spoke into his ear.
Yedaber nadavar beozne. Yeah. Closeness. Intimacy. That's perfect. What is Yehuda telling Yosef? What's Yehuda telling Yosef in that whole thing?
He's telling the whole story.
He's telling him the whole story. And then there's such closeness, and it breaks the viceroy, that meaning it breaks the person behind the mask down. Because the closeness that was established through the story brought the reunification of all the brothers together. Mamish, very good. So look at this. Masbir Rav Moshe, now Rav Neria, he's going to address another piece of this pasuk. Very interesting piece of the pasuk. מי הם בנך ובן בנך האמורים בכתוב אשר עליהם נאמר ולמען תספר? Who are the children and the grandchildren that the pasuk is referring to? Meaning the question I think is like this. Why do you have to tell someone a story that happened to them as well? Meaning Hashem is telling Moshe and the Yidden, tell your children what happened, but our children are here with us. Well, not everybody. Look what he points out. Rak shnei yeladim ivriim bodedim lo zachu lirot et nisei Mitzrayim be'et hitrachshutam. There were only two Jewish boys that did not see all the makot. They did not experience the miracles. Who were they? Shnei banav shel Moshe. Gershom ve'Eliezer. Because where were they? Be'et hitrachshutam. בעת התרחשות הניסים והנפלאות, בכל משך תקופת היציאה ממצרים, הם ישבו במרחקים, במדיין. This is unbelievable. Moshe Rabbeinu's children were the only children of any parent there that really needed to hear a story. Because they weren't there. They were in Midian. Remember, he reunites with them afterwards, after the whole thing happens. But they were the only ones, they were the only children that didn't witness it. I never thought, no, that's just an incredible shift of focus for a second on the story of the Yetzias Mitzrayim. And it makes us look at Moshe Rabbeinu quite differently. This is like a, you know, this is a completely different story, but it's part of the same story. It's Moshe Rabbeinu's story. Like, we never really think about his story so much. We think about his story as in terms of the Am, but his own private life, we know very little. But the fact that we know that his children weren't with him really calls out to us a lot about how do we look at the story of Yetzias Mitzrayim. So he continues, Mufla Adavai, third line. Zacha klal Yisrael lirot et hanisim hagdolim ve'et hayad hachazaka asher asa Hashem b'Mitzrayim ba'al sfat hayam. The nation merited seeing all these miracles. מדוע דווקא בני משה לא זכו לראות עין בעין את יד השם במצרים? על מה עשה השם ככה? How could it be that God planned it out? That Moshe Rabbeinu's children were the ones that didn't merit to see with their own eyes what everyone else saw? He's almost feeling like, wow. He's like, how could it be that Hashem is like sticking it to Moshe Rabbeinu more than to anybody else? The only children that didn't witness the miracles which made us into a nation are Moshe's children. Alma asa Hashem kacha. Like that voice that happens to maybe some of us once in a while. Why me? Why my children? Why my story? Why is my story different than everybody else's? I remember talking about this in Shir the other day about comparative reality. Moshe Rabbeinu had the greatest legitimate claim to have a taina on God about comparative reality. Why did I have to go through this? Pretty good taina, no? Yeshiv al kach echad migdolei admorim. So one of the rebbes answered like this. Kol ha'avot bedor yotzei Mitzrayim netulei yecholet hem lesaper et hasipur kehitrachshuto. All the fathers in the generation of those that left Egypt were unable to really tell the story as it took place. Why? Shari kasher hem sipru et sipur hayetzia bashana hashniya letzeta mimitzrayim livneihem. Because when they found themselves a year later, what was the year later? Pesach. What's it time for? Okay, let me tell you the story of what happened, right? Where they find themselves? The parents and the children knew this is just a repetition. What is he saying over here? He's saying, you ever try to give over a story to someone that witnessed exactly what you're telling? So what are you basically doing? You're recapping. You're not telling a story. Recapping is not telling a story. He's saying an amazing thing here. He's saying all the people that left Egypt with their children, then they had to give over the story to their children the next year because that was the mitzvah. What was the best they could do? Just like reminisce. Really? But when you have to give over to someone that wasn't there, what do you have to do? You have to live what you're saying in the moment. who was the only person that Mamish had to live what they were saying the first year after leaving Egypt? Moshe Rabbeinu. Because everyone else, they were there. Do you hear what he's saying over here? It's a brilliant thing. המספר הראשון שהתאפשר לו לספר את סיפור היציאה המלא, the first storyteller, who it was enabled to him to really give over the full story, במלוא עוצמת החוויה, with the utmost of giving over the experience of it, ובעוז אמונה, and with the strength of אמונה, מתוך אספקלריה המאירה, from this clear vision, הוא משה רבינו, שיספר את סיפור יציאת מצרים. That's why the Torah says to Moshe Rabbeinu, listen, Moshe, really? Everyone's going to have to give over to their children. But for this first generation, these words were just for him. Leman tesaper beoznei bincha. You have to give it over to the ears of your children. That's why I think it doesn't say leman tesapru beoznei bneichem. You don't have to give it over in such an intimate way to your children if your children were already there. Only one person has to do that. That's why the Lashon here is Lashon Yachid. It's a Lashon of singular. Leman tesaper beoznei ben bincha. Because this whole thing was just for Moshe Rabbeinu to establish closeness with his children. That as much as he was doing his big gig of being the Redeemer, being the leader, Hashem says to him, you won't feel redemption if you don't feel close to your children during this story. All the greatest things in the world can happen to all those that are around you, but if you are not close to what you're giving over to everybody else, it won't mean anything to you. And Hashem saying, Moshe, I need you redeemed as well. I really need you. Not just to be the shliach, to take care of everybody else. You need to feel it as well. So here this whole vort is, Hashem set up the whole thing for him, saying, it's you, Moshe, that needs the intimacy more than anybody else over here. Why? Because they already, when they give over the story next year, they're just reminiscing. They're just going over the same thing together. They don't have to play back the whole thing live, full on, because they both felt it, father and son. But you're going to have to explain to your children. Go into their ears. I like what you're saying, Miriam. Close. Give it over. That's what establishes, not just closeness, but it'll establish your children to ask you shailas then, to ask you, really, what was it like? What was it like? So I'll just end with a very, very strong vort that we once said. And by the way, we can go on and on with this. We haven't even done half of the material that we prepared. There's a lot here. But this is really the story of Pesach. It's the story of our lives. It's the story of the future of Geula. You know what really brought Simcha to Am Yisrael when they were told about the Geula? It's in our Parsha. It says, at a certain point in the Parsha, it says that Vayikod Ha'am Vayishtachu, that they really got down and made a kida, and they bowed down to before Hashem. And we learned already, what's a kida? A kida is literally, in normal Hebrew, is a curtsy. Kri kida, right? Take a bow, right? That's how you say curtsy, right? That's how you say it. So what caused them, so the Gemara in Sukkah says that a kida was what the Nasi, Rabbi Shem ben Gamliel, used to do during Simchas Beis HaShoeva. It was actually a thumb stand, literally. He used to do thumb stands in Simchas Beis HaShoeva. That's why the Gemara says, whoever didn't see Simchas Beis HaShoeva never saw a part of this before in their lives. Why? Because can you imagine Rabbi Riss, not Lehavdil, for us, he's the head of this place, right? Can you imagine him going on his thumb, even 20 years ago, doing a thumb stand? Okay, now take that image and go to Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel, the Nasi of the Sanhedrin. And he's doing thumb sends. Rashi says he was able to kind of balance himself. Mamish, martial arts stuff. And that's what caused such simcha at that moment at Simchas Beis HaShoeva. So the amazing thing over here is that the Am reached that place in this parsha of real simcha. What caused them to do a kida? So you look at the pasuk before. The pasuk before, Hashem tells them, your children are going to have questions. Your children are going to have questions. Vayikodam vayishtachu. Why were they so happy? Because Hashem told them that your children are going to be interested in your masoret, in what you're all about. And when we see that our children are interested, not even fully with us, but interested, even asking questions like, Ma avodah zot lachem, that there's no greater simcha a parent can have when a child is a little bit interested in what they see their parent doing. And the way to instill interest and sakranut, a sakran means to be curious, curiosity, is through stories. So alavai, we should be privileged to incorporate the role of storytelling into the ge'ula of our own families in a very, very strong way, and through that merit, Be'ez Hashem Yisbarach, to really look at our lives as stories, like we started speaking about tonight, and the bottom line is to feel close to the stories that we're giving over, and to the stories that we're telling HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Hashem doesn't need you to make proclamations all day long. Hashem doesn't need anything. But what the Ribbono Shel Olam would want of you, more than just you making statements all day long, is for you to actually feel close to what you're telling Him. And that really is the power of Hisbodedus, which one day, we're going to look back. I think Reb Nosson even said this. Reb Nosson says, one day Yiddishkeit, Yidden are going to look back at Yiddishkeit, and they're going to be like, isn't it crazy that for so many years, Jews thought and they treated Hisbodedus as optional? Isn't that funny? He said, a day is going to come, we're going to look back and be like, that Jews actually thought they could like feel authentic Yidden, like they're authentic Jews, without Hisbodedus. I think we're getting closer to there. I think it's getting clearer and clearer that without feeling close to Hashem, you almost should say, like, don't expect a thing from your children. Don't put it on them. Don't expect a thing from them. It's not fair to them.
We should truly know Hashem. Yishar koach, everyone. Thank you for coming.